Right, so today, yeah. So some of you have already seen my 15-minute talk, but I will not assume that you've seen it. So I'm going to speak about this asymptotic spectra, the theory of asymptotic spectra. It's a very general theory, so it applies in some general abstract setting of semi-rings. But I'm going to start with some motivating examples, being matrix multiplication, Shannon capacity of graphs, set, which corresponds to the cap set problem, of course. And then I will introduce you to these three explicit asymptotic spectra, more explicit settings, so matrices, tensors, and graphs, and then we'll see this abstract version. So I made notes, the notes are on my website. I mean, it's the notes I'm using here, you can see them on my website. So the stuff I'm talking about comes from papers from Strassen, papers of me with my co-authors, Matthias Cristando and Peter Vrana, and my thesis. So let's just get started with these motivations. So matrix multiplication, we've seen it already last week, a little bit in Avi's talk. So you're given two matrices, huge matrices that you want to multiply. Yeah? So n by n matrices, you want to multiply them. And we're interested in how many additions and multiplications in the field do we need to do this matrix multiplication? And trivially, you need at most like 2n cubed. If you would do it by hand, you would do like 2n cubed operations. And if you look closely at the problem, you will see that you will need at least like n squared. Yeah, so we're interested in, can we do better than n cubed? How close can we get to n squared? And somehow we make it a little bit simpler, so we focus only on the exponent. Yeah, so we're interested in what's the optimal exponent, omega, and it's the optimal exponent of n. So somehow, so we're not going to care about this constant c in front, so this constant can grow. So this will be useful if n is very big, if n is big enough. So let me. So I want to draw somehow the history. Let me do it here, because I think it's useful to know more or less how this went over time. So the trivial algorithm uses an exponent of 3. Yeah. And some of the lower bound is 2.0. Now the first improvement was by Volker Strassen. We've seen this already. So Volker Strassen moved it down to like 2.8. And this was in 68. And then not much happened until 78. So many techniques were invented around 1980, yeah, moving it down to like 2.5. Yeah, so this involves many people, and we will see some of the techniques that they used. Maybe not very explicitly, but. And then after a while, Strassen, Kopperschmidt, and Wienergrad moved it down to like 2.37, more or less. And that's more or less how it is still is today. So here is again some interesting new techniques. So let me maybe say these things we're going to see. So direct sum is one of the things that are important in this area, and also border rank. And over here, it's the laser method of Strassen. And the Kopperschmidt-Wienergrad method. And the Kopperschmidt-Wienergrad method has to do also with set. We'll see that later, the cap set problem.
Do the techniques build upon each other?
These build on each other, yeah. Yeah. And these are also used again here. This all builds on each other, actually. Yeah. Right. So the lower bound. Yeah, I made this joke during the 15-minute talk about the lower bound. So the lower bound is, but the lower bound is just a straight line. But things have happened. So the asymptotic spectrum of tensors is one of the is like a theory of lower bounds. And so this Strassen published this in this at this time, and we have a new result on the asymptotic spectrum of tensors. So that's like our result here in 2018. Yeah. So not much has happened in the asymptotic low bound setting. All right. So let me briefly. So Avi has mentioned how this relates to tensors. So let me briefly recall how this works. So you have a matrix multiplication tensor. And the idea is that we need to compute the tensor rank. So if you, I will redefine the tensor rank later, okay? But let me just recall what we've seen earlier. So the idea will be that if we can compute the so-called tensor rank of this tensor, then we know more or less the complexity of n by n matrix multiplication. Okay, so somehow I want to move to tensors as quickly as possible. Now there is a crucial property of matrix multiplication. It's this self-reducibility property. If you multiply matrices, then you can also multiply them blockwise. Yeah? And on the tensor level, what this means is that if you take two of these matrix multiplication tensors and you take their Kronecker product, I'll define this more precisely later, then you get another matrix multiplication tensor. And as a consequence of this, so first of all, so let me redefine omega as, so it's this exponent, so it's an infimum over n of the logarithm base n of the rank of this matrix multiplication tensor. And because of this self-reducibility, you can rewrite this as 2 to the omega is the infimum over m of the rank of the smallest matrix multiplication tensor to the power m, and then the mth root. And this is like this is the asymptotic rank of the matrix multiplication tensor. So I'm going to be more precise about this later. I just want to tell you that tensors is what we need. So we need to look at tensors.
There's a point to make about the sum of self-reducibility of matrix multiplication. It totally assumes that you can compute the matrix multiplication over non-commutative elements, over non-commutative rings, because this blockwise thing sort of takes it for granted. So what we are after is, you know, it could have been that the commutative setting is easier somehow, or not.
Yes, it could be, yeah.
But I guess everybody assumes that we are working in the non-commutative setting, and that's what we are out to.
Yeah,
omega is really the exponent in the non-commutative.
If you want to like recursively apply your matrix multiplication algorithm, and you want to do this like blockwise, then you need that then you cannot assume that the elements commute.
Exactly.
Yeah. But this tensor framework takes care of that somehow. All right. So let me do something new now. Now I want to look at Shannon capacity. So this is a topic in information theory, or at least that's how it started. So you're given a communication channel, and it's a noisy channel. So we have 5 inputs, and we have 5 outputs, and the inputs map to the outputs. So you would like that it's like an identity map or something, or like 1 goes to A and 2 goes to B, 3 goes to C. That would be ideal. Then you have a useful communication channel. But it's a noisy channel. So what happens is that sometimes the 1 is sent to the B, and sometimes 2 is sent to C, etc. And 5 is mapped all the way to A.
Sent to, you mean the channel computer?
Yeah, so I mean that there is a sender. It wants to send, it inputs the symbol 1, and then the receiver receives either A or B with some probability. But your goal is to send information like with zero error. Okay, so you're given this channel. How many symbols can you send with zero error? Well, so what you should do is restrict the input. Okay, so you restrict the input. So you decide, oh, let's only use 1 and 3. If I use only these inputs, then the receiver gets say A or B, then it knows, oh, it came from a 1, or it gets C and D or C or D, and knows, oh, it came from 3. So in this one-shot protocol, in this one-shot setting, I can send 2 symbols. Now the idea is, what can we do if we can use the channel multiple times? So now I get the channel twice. The input will look like pairs. And so, for example, 1, 1, I send it into the channel. It can be sent to like A, A, for example, or A, B, or B, A, or B, B. But if you look at 2, 3, then you'll see that it will not be sent to the same outputs as the 1, 1 is sent to. So it turns out that if you use this channel twice, so what you can do is you can use the symbols 1, 1, 2, 3, 3, 5, 4, 2, and 5, 4. And you'll see that none of these get confused by the channel. So 1 and 2 can be sent to the same symbol, but 1 and 3 cannot be sent to the same symbol. Yeah? So these two words, if you put them in the channel, you get different words. The receiver get different words. Yeah. So now you would expect that if you use a channel twice, you can send 4 symbols, but we can actually send 5 symbols or 5 words. So the idea is to look at the asymptotic. So what happens asymptotically? So you define the sharing capacity. As the supremum over n of the n-shot capacity of your channel, and then you take the nth root. And again, I want to move to simpler objects, so I want to move to graphs. You want to move to graphs here? Because in these channels, there's a little bit too much information. You don't really need to know where exactly your symbols are sent. You only need to know which inputs can be confused. So you construct a confusability graph. And the nodes of the graph are given by the input symbols. And nodes are connected when they can be confused by the channel. Okay, so in this case, you get a 5-cycle if you look at it. So the confusability graph of this channel is a 5-cycle. And if you think about the goal, the goal is to find an independent set in this graph, meaning you need to find vertices, a subset of the vertices that are pairwise non-adjacent. Yeah, so that's called an independent set, and the independence number alpha is the independence number of the graph, is the size of the largest independent set in the graph. And if you now, this is for one channel use. So what happens if you use the channel twice? You will get a new confusability graph. And let's just say that this is C5. I use the channel twice, I get a new confusability graph. Let me call it the square of C5. It's the strong graph product. And the Shannon capacity then becomes the following. So for a general graph, it becomes a supremum of O n of the independence number of g to the power n, 1 over n. And so the Shannon capacity is, we don't know how to compute it, and we don't know whether it's computable. Also for small graphs, often we don't know what the Shannon capacity is. So I can give you an example.
So you claim that this confusibility graph, the tensor power, is determined by the original confusibility graph and not the channel?
Yeah. The confusibility graph describes the whole problem. That's an important, very important property. Yeah, I'll tell you the formula later, okay?
We don't know how to compute this efficiently, or we don't know how to compute
We don't know whether Shannon capacity is computable. We do know that that independence number is NP-hard to decide, to compute. So that also makes it hard. So what we do know, for example, is that if you look at C5, this is a non-trivial result. Then the Shannon capacity is the square root of 5. That's a result of Laszlo Lovaas. We'll see later how he does it. The lower bound follows from this construction. I can send 5 symbols, I take square root. But the upper bound is hard. Now, another example, a recent example of the order, or the state of the art for C7, for example, is like this. So there's a gap. This lower bound is by Polak and Schrijver. The upper bound is by Lovaas. It's a very small graph, and we don't know what the Shannon capacity is.
Is it expected to always be an algebraic number?
We don't know. I don't know. So there is a, it's, yeah.
Wait, right, maybe I should add, are the upper and lower bounds algebraic numbers in this case?
Yeah, I think the lower bound, yeah, I think
the rational numbers.
The upper bound comes from
because it's really an example bounds. Where the limit is not.
So the upper bound comes from the Lovaas theta number, so I think, but I'm
not clear. The upper bound is not clear. It comes from semi-definite problems.
Oh, okay.
I think what's known is that if this is an equality, then it cannot come from a finite power of C7.
Oh, okay.
Because, so here it comes from a finite power of C5. Here, if this is an equality, then this will not be a finite power. Exactly. All right, so that's Shannon capacity. Set. Let's talk about set. So, well, set is a card game, but let's keep it mathematical. So,
that's probably worthwhile saying Lovaas' result is from the late 70s, and C7 was the next challenge. For microsized graphs, this is easy. So, the next thing was C7, and people don't, and lots of people worked on it.
Yeah.
There's nothing much happened in these 50 years or so.
Right. So set, so we look at the space Z modulo 3 to the power 4. And I take 3 points in here, x, y, z. And I say they form a line if they are on a line. So if they are of the form, so if x, y, z is of the form u plus v, u plus 2v with v non-zero. Yeah, then these 3 points are on a line. Now, how large can a line-free subset be in this space? So that's the question. How large can line-free, meaning so no triples form a line, subset A of the whole space B. So that's the question. This corresponds really to the game set where you have your cards on the table, and So you have cards on the table corresponding to these elements, and you need to find a line. That's the goal, and then you shout set. This corresponds to how many cards can be on the table without you being able to find a set. And it's like 21 or something. Okay. But now in the cap set problem, what you do is you're not interested in this finite case. You're interested in what happens if I let this be n, and I let this be n. And I want to know what happens asymptotically. Yeah, and then the results are as follows. So there's a low bound, 2.4, and there's an upper bound, 2.755. And this is by Gijswijd and Ellenberg, and this is by Edel. And so that's the state of the art on this problem. So somehow what we see in all these problems is that there is a construction side. This is a constructive. Getting these lower bounds is a construction. And in some way, you get an upper bound by finding some kind of obstruction. And in the Shannon capacity situation, it's the same. So here, to get this lower bound, you need to find these large independent sets. So it's really a construction. And here, in some clever way, you find some kind of obstruction. But it's completely unclear what these obstructions should look like from the beginning. Same there. And
you can say that in the set case, until this breakthrough 2-3 years ago, for probably several decades, the best upper bound was 3 to the n over n.
Right.
Because people thought of it as being very similar to arithmetic, three-term arithmetic progression, three set in the integers, and that were more or less.
Right. Exactly. Yeah, and let me go back to this matrix multiplication setting here. Yeah, so here we know it's between 2 and 2.37. Here it's the other way around, so obstructions are like the lower bounds. It's not completely clear how to get them. Constructions are the upper bound. Somehow it's clear what you have to do. You have to come with rank decompositions, like rank upper bounds. All right, so that's the motivation. So are there any questions about this?
Can you rephrase this game in a tensor form?
So it's about supports of tensors. And then you can move to tensors. Yeah, and I will do that next week. It's related, yeah. All right. Okay, so let's move to the asymptotic spectra. Let's see, let's just start here. So I'm going to start very simple. It's the asymptotic spectrum of matrices. So matrices, well, we all know matrices, but I want to have a nice pre-order on matrices. So suppose I have two matrices, M and N. So they can be of arbitrary dimensions, okay? And they are over some field, which is fixed. So I define a pre-order as follows. I say M is smaller than N if there exists two matrices A and B such that M can be written as A times N times B transpose. Transpose is not very important. Yeah, so somehow you should think, so somehow A and B, they act on this this N to get M.
What is the intuition?
I don't know. So for tensors, this will be I don't know really what the intuition is. This is what you get if you take what you do with tensors and you go to matrices. So for tensors, this will give us tensor rank, and we'll get matrix rank. That's maybe the intuition. So let me continue and.
A and B need not be invertible.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not clear from the definition, but if M and N are given, if they are related.
So maybe this, maybe the intuition is as follows. So I will define now the rank of M as the minimum number n such that M is smaller than the identity matrix, the n by n identity matrix. And this is matrix rank. It's not hard to check that, that this is actually matrix rank. And there's another way.
This M and N could be different size.
Yes, yes, yes.
Are they always square or?
Anything,
n.
Yeah.
Right.
Any matrices. Now what's interesting is that you can actually write this also as a maximization over all n, such that the n by n identity matrix is smaller than m. And the way to prove this is with Gaussian elimination. Yeah. So this is in, so there are two ways to describe this matrix rank. And matrix rank is a very nice function. It satisfies all kinds of properties. So for example, you can define the Kronecker product on matrices, right? Sometimes called tensor product, right? You just multiply m 1 1 with n, etc. So it's like a get this block matrix. And you can define the direct sum. By putting your matrices on the main diagonal like this. And matrix rank has a, satisfies a nice property with respect to these operations. So let me write it like this. So here's a theorem. So let X of matrices be the set of all maps phi from matrices to the reals, the non-negative reals, such that the map is multiplicative. So phi m tensor n equals phi m phi n. The map is additive. Phi of the direct sum equals the sum of the phi's. Phi is normalized on identity matrices. So phi of in equals n. And the last one is monotonicity. If m is smaller than n, then phi of m is smaller than phi of n. And the theorem statement is that you only get matrix rank. So then X of matrices equals only matrix rank this is actually not so hard to prove. I won't do it here, but I think people you can prove this as an exercise. So this is the situation for matrices, like super easy. The asymptotic spectrum has a single element, it's matrix rank. Any questions? Is like definitions are clear? Or?
What is the asymptotic spectrum in general?
It's in general, we'll see later. I'm going to move to the general thing. This is just what you already know, matrices. So now we're going to do tensors. So here again, so I take two tensors.
Is there any other partial order on whatever algebraic structure for which you have such a characterization?
On which object? Or?
Whatever you choose. Is there any other example like rank of matrices where there is only one solution?
Oh, only one solution.
Yeah. The difference.
I think you can always. That's a good question. I think. There might be I have to think about it. There might be some quantum pre-orders on graphs that gives you only Lovas theta or something. But yeah, I have to think about it. I don't really have an example immediately. So for tensors, so let's take two tensors. So tensors are just three-dimensional arrays. Yeah, they can have any dimensions, but they have three indices, and they are over some field again. And now again, I want to define when is t smaller than s, and it's a generalization of this pre-order. So what you do is, I say t is smaller than s if there are three matrices, A, B, C, such that I can obtain t from S by applying these three matrices. So I will tell you what it means to S. What it means is that you, if I write it out, I get the following. So A I A B J B C K C S A B C. This is the IJK entry of this, yeah. This is the definition of this.
So just change basis along the fibers in each dimension.
Yeah. You can think of T and S as multilinear maps from a product of vector spaces, and you change the basis. But it's not really a change of basis because it can be non-invertible.
Yeah.
Yeah, you apply you pre-compose with linear maps. That's what's happening.
T and S can be different sizes and arbitrary rectangular things.
Yeah. In practice, you can, I guess, always put your stuff in the same dimension. But yeah, anything, yeah.
You can always add the zero if you want, if you prefer that.
Yeah. So now, okay, so what did we do for matrices? We looked at these formulas, and they turned out to be equal, etc. So now let's do the same thing. I cannot move it up. All right. So, first definition. So, rank R of T. Let's just start with the first. So, it's the minimum over all n, such that T is smaller than In, which in this case is now the n by n by n identity tensor. So, think of a tensor as a cube of elements, then it means that you have ones on the main diagonal and zeros elsewhere. Yeah, so this is now my definition of rank, and this turns out to be the same thing as tensor rank as we've seen it in Avi's talk, so the minimum number of simple summons that you need to write your tensor. This is very well studied, tensor rank. Now there is this other formula, the maximization, and it turns out it gives a different number. So that's called subrank. Q of T. So that's this maximization over all n, such that In is smaller than T. Yeah, so instead of having to construct T from the identity tensor, I need to construct now the identity tensor from my tensor, T. So yeah, they're different. So I think we'll see why. So next we looked at these products and direct sums. So you can define these again for tensors. So you have a Kronecker product for tensors. Again, you do this in a blockwise fashion. So this tensor, if you look at, now the coordinates are given by pairs, and the coefficients are given by all possible products. Elements of T and S. That's the Kronecker product, and the direct sum is easier to just draw. So you put your one tensor, and then you put the other one next to it, touching only in a corner. So that's the direct sum. Okay. Just go here. Now, tensor rank will not be multiplicative under this tensor product, under this Kronecker product. And that's how that's how somehow you think of coming up with this asymptotic tensor rank. So asymptotic tensor rank R tilde for tensor T. Let's define it as a limit n going to infinity of the rank of T to the power n 1 over n. And it turns out you can replace this limit by an infimum, because rank is submultiplicative. Yeah, so this limit actually exists, and it's equal to the infimum over these numbers. Yeah, so it's really some kind of minimization problem. And on the opposite side, the asymptotic subrank, you define it in the same way, but now you put a subrank. And here you can prove that you can replace the limit by a supremum. So this is really a maximization problem. And if you put all these objects together, what you will get is that you have the subrank, and then you have the asymptotic subrank, and then the asymptotic rank, and then the rank of the tensor. And these can all be different. Okay, so this is really this situation is completely different from what you have for matrices. So I can give you an example where they're all different. It's the same tensor as Avi used in his talk. It's this tensor, so E0. This is an outer product now, it's not a Kronecker product. So this is sometimes called the W tensor. And what happens for these four parameters is that the subrank is 1. The asymptotic subrank is 2 to the power, the entropy of 1/3. Here you get 2. And the rank is 3. So we'll see later how you come up with this number.
What is that?
This is the entropy. This is the binary entropy of 1/3. So P is a number between 0 and 1, then the binary entropy of P is minus P times, let's do logarithm base 2 of P, minus 1 minus P, logarithm of 1 minus P. All right, so that's the first remark. These can all be different. And the second remark is that also that here, actually, in the setting of tensors, we do know that this is not attained, that there are examples where this is not attained by a finite power. So that's a result of Kopperschmidt and Vinogrod. So there, make the remark. So in general, so there exists a tensor T. You can take the matrix multiplication tensor, such that for all n, the asymptotic rank of T is strictly smaller than the rank of T to the power n 1 over n. So this is really, so you can...
I thought you said that the minimum is attained in the...
What I said is that this can be replaced by an infimum.
By infimum? Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And you cannot replace it by a minimum in general. No, not in the construction we have, and I think it probably satisfies. Yeah, I don't know if you can. I have to look at the.
So another question: is this property generic?
The property for this T to have this. The conditions are very simple, but I have to. We could look at it. Yeah, probably. These are very simple conditions, I think, for this tool.
So
yeah, right. So that's of course a different situation. That's not tensors.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's a good question. We don't know. We don't know. And this proof maybe will not help us understanding that. Maybe it will. So let's now go to this asymptotic spectrum. I can just leave this.
anybody gives us for improving lower bounds on the rank of tensors, you can try to prove lower bounds on the asymptotic rank of tensors, at least.
Right.
It's a friendlier thing, maybe.
Right.
Yeah, but we'll talk about it.
And that's what we're going to move to, indeed. Yeah. So what can these lower bounds look like? And that's the asymptotic spectrum of tensors, you could say. So let me define x, or the x of tensors, the asymptotic spectrum of tensors, as the set of all maps from tensors to the reals that satisfy, again, these four properties that we have for matrices, but then for tensors, with the new operations that we now have for tensors. Yeah? So the four properties, let's maybe, yeah. So we need that it's multiplicative, additive, on the direct sum, normalized on identity tensors, and monotone under this pre-order that I defined. So this is just the definition of X. So what can we do? So suppose now we have an element in X. What's it good for? Well, so lemma. If you take any phi in X, then we have that phi lies between the asymptotic subrank and the asymptotic rank. And let me just prove one direction. It's not so hard. Yeah, so phi gives lower bounds on asymptotic rank. That's really what we want. And also gives upper bounds on asymptotic subrank, which is also what we want, actually. Maybe it's not clear, but this is exactly what you want if you want to solve the cap set problem. So proof. So okay, let me rewrite. So let's begin with asymptotic rank. It's this limit and you can rephrase this. You can say, okay, it means that the rank of t to the power n is smaller than the asymptotic rank of t to the power n plus little o of n. And then I want to, what's the definition of rank for tensors? It means that t to the power n is smaller than the identity tensor of this size. That was the definition. And then I can apply phi on both sides. So phi comes from X. So it's a monotone under this pre-order. So this is an inequality of tensors. Eh? So I can apply phi on both sides, and then I get an inequality of numbers, of real numbers. So I get that phi of t to the power n is smaller than phi applied to this, but phi is normalized. So we get this number over here. Okay, but this is just an inequality of real numbers. So now I can take the nth root on both sides. And I can let n go to infinity. And then we end up with phi of t is smaller than the asymptotic rank of t. So there's really not much happening here. These are just using the properties. Actually, these properties are a little bit too strong. But yeah, we didn't use additivity. We also didn't use, we only used supermultiplicativity. So you don't really need submultiplicativity.
Okay. Well, for the other direction, you need
yeah.
the other.
If you, yeah, that's right. If you want to prove this, then you need submultiplicativity.
Additivity is not used at all.
Additivity is not used. Okay. This is something extra. Well, so, yeah. Let me state the theorem of Strassen. Let me leave this, and then we move here. Oh, let's just do this first. Right, so there are all these properties that we're not using, so what's the deal with that? So here's Strassen's theorem. If you minimize, fix some tensor T, you look at phi evaluated at T, and you minimize over all phi in X, then you actually get asymptotic subrank. And in the other direction, if you maximize over all phi in X, then you actually get asymptotic rank. So we didn't use some of these properties here, but it only makes the result stronger that we can actually put them. Yeah? So it makes your search easier. Okay, we're looking for these lower bounds on asymptotic rank. And now we know that it's enough to consider lower bounds of this form. So okay. Not clear that's going to help, but you should look for these maps. And a priori, you would think, oh, okay, there needs to be super multiplicative, maybe monotone is nice, normalized. Turns out that you can make it a little bit stronger. Yeah. So
it's a duality theorem.
It's a duality theorem. That's the other way of looking at this, because asymptotic rank is like an infimum. It's like a minimization problem. And now in this theorem, we see, oh, it's also a maximization over some other objects. So it's a duality theorem.
But the theorem should hold even if you remove the second condition,
right? Yes. Yeah. Then it still holds. That immediately follows.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because X becomes...
It would be a weaker duality theorem.
Yeah, yeah. You're right. But,
but I don't see how you're gaining something by asking.
So there are two things. You're gaining two things. So it's a smaller set. So it will be easier to look. It will be you have some guidance in looking for them.
But we don't know how these maps look like.
Well, sometimes we do. We have examples. We don't know if we have all of them.
But suppose you wanted the asymptotic rank. Suppose you wanted to know it. It just tells you search in this small box rather than in the bigger box in which you don't require additivity.
Well, that's assuming we can find the best one.
Yeah, but anyway, it just restricts your search to a smaller set. So it's a stronger duality theorem if you can put more conditions on this.
But there is another thing you gain, and we will see this later. It's somehow the fact that you can describe asymptotic rank as a maximization over maps that have these properties and also additivity. It will tell us something about asymptotic rank. We're going to gain a property of asymptotic rank, some kind of property relating to direct sum and tensor product. We'll see it later.
Well,
yeah.
But it is clear from the definition that you have you are characterizing asymptotic rank by this property. Right?
Yeah, but so we will see an extra result coming from that. There's also this. Dark sum.
So can you just tell us, this is supposed to be related, or Strassen was motivated or influenced or used this duality theory for all the drinks of Singer and somebody. So there was a...
Cadisson-Dubois.
Cadisson and Dubois.
Yeah. So he used this as a black box. Yeah. There's a theory of Cadisson and Dubois. It's about... So I'm going to talk about this abstract setting, but I will do it in an integrated way. So, but there's this older theory. Cadisson Dubois, and he used it to prove this.
So this is super deep.
In the end, well, it's not trivial. Yeah. No, I mean it's non-trivial. Yeah, is it deep? So it's the proof in the end. If you integrate it, it's not necessarily so long. But it's non-trivial. I think some non-trivial results come from it. We'll see it also in the graph setting. So in the tensor setting. One of the reasons that Strassen looked at this is because of something called the Schoenaerge-Tau theorem. It says something about how asymptotic rank behaves with respect to direct sum and tensor product. This is somehow, I think, how he came up with it. We'll see it later. I should make a remark actually here. So, because otherwise the theorem is trivial. So asymptotic subrank and asymptotic rank are not in X. Okay, that's important, because if they are in X, then this is a trivial statement. And the other one too, okay? And the way to see this, you can see this using matrix multiplication. So you can write the matrix multiplication tensor, you can actually write it as a tensor product of, this is like a very small, this is like multiplying a two vectors, this is like an inner product of two vectors. Somehow you can decompose it as a tensor product. And these will have asymptotic rank 2, and this we know has asymptotic rank smaller than 7 at least, so even smaller. Okay, so let's just, So I want to finish with telling you three trivial.
So just to make sure, so this depends on t. So fact that, so every t has a different minimizer or maximizer.
A priori, yeah, that's right. That's what this tells you. Yeah. For any t, you can try to find this phi.
So is this set X finite?
No.
It's
not finite.
It's non-trivial that you write in maximum.
Sorry?
It is non-trivial that you write in
that's
maximum.
That's all, yeah.
And
yeah.
This, what is the underlying field here?
It doesn't matter yet.
So everything here works for anything.
Yeah. In matrix multiplication, there are not many results that really, so asymptotically, we don't have any results that distinguish between fields. Only yeah. Good. I want to tell you the trivial points. So maybe I switch these boards. So that's an example. They are called flattenings. So there are three flattenings. So how does it work? You have your tensor. It has three indices. Yeah, it's indexed by triples. Let me just write it down again. Now, I can just group together these two of these, like this. And then it becomes a matrix. I can just view a tensor as a matrix. But there are three ways to do this, because I can group it like this. I can group N1 and N3 together, or N1 and N2. Yeah, so there are three flattenings. And then when you have a matrix, you can take matrix rank. So doing this gives you 3 points in the asymptotic spectrum of tensors. So I can define Ri by taking t, so let's say this is t1. I can take t and I map it to the matrix rank of the ith flattening. And this it's easy to prove that this is an element in the asymptotic spectrum of tensors. So that's really the trivial thing to do. It's a trivial thing to do, but then it also gives the best part, it's the best thing we can do actually in terms of lower bounds on asymptotic rank. So I want to mention an open problem here. So that's actually the open problem. Is there a tensor T such that the maximum over these flattening rings is strictly smaller than the asymptotic rank of T? So if you take T, the matrix multiplication tensor, then you're solving a very big problem. If you take some other tensor, then you're actually also solving a very big problem. But so we don't know any tensor T. So next week, so I'm going to stop with tensors. So next week I will describe how to construct an infinite family in X over the complex numbers and also over other fields, and I will also describe the relation to set to the capsid problem. I think now maybe we can have a 5-minute break or something.
But with respect to this open problem,
Yeah.
I mean, one thing to say is you don't even know that R tilde of t will not be the minimum of this.
The minimum? Sorry.
Maximum.
Oh.
Yeah. Let's say when they're equal, let's say m and n, you don't know any example where the asymptotic rank is bigger than n even.
Yeah, but that's somehow what I mean by saying this. But I understand.
No, but it's related because you cannot expect really.
I think it's the same question, to be honest. But
it is the same.
You're saying I have t. I put it in, let's say this space. But I have to be a little bit careful with what n is. No, because I can increase n.
Yeah, well, let's just say you take the support, the subspaces where it sits.
Exactly, I need to take n minimum.
Yeah.
That's what you mean. But taking n minimum is the same as looking at these. Looking at these flattening rings.
Yeah, I understand. But with respect to the right-hand side, the asymptotic rank, once you took n minimum.
You're right. That's true.
Maybe it's a bigger open question. I'm not sure. It's a somewhat different open question. Just find a t.
Yeah.
Where the asymptotic rank is bigger than the dimension.
Yeah, I think it's the same question. But
the same question?
I think so, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Good. Well, it's another phrase.
Yeah. So let's take a. Are there any questions? Otherwise, take a. So that's next week. All right. So we have seen asymptotic spectrum of matrices, which was like super easy. There was only rank. And then we saw the asymptotic spectrum of tensors, which at least has 3 points, and it has more, which we'll see later. And we saw this duality, yeah. So we've seen that we can get Q tilde and R tilde as minimizations maximizations and minimizations. Minimizations and maximizations. So that's that. Now there's an abstract theory. And you can apply it to this tensor setting, but we can also apply it to graphs. And then we get the asymptotic spectrum of graphs. So that's what we're going to do now. And what's going to happen is that we can, instead of characterizing this asymptotic subrank, what we're going to do is we're going to characterize the Shannon capacity of a graph, yeah, which was this object, which was this parameter coming from communication channels and etc. So this is going to be. This is naturally a supremum, but we're going to see that it's a minimization over this x of graphs. And you can also look at the maximization. You will get the asymptotic clique cover number of a graph. Okay, it's the maximum. So let's do this. So this is for the asymptotic spectrum of graphs. So a graph, well, we know what a graph is. A graph is just a vertex set and an edge set. So E is a set of pairs of vertices, unordered pairs. And my graphs don't have self loops, okay? No self loops. So examples are, for example, the cycle graph. We've seen that already. We've seen C5. Yeah. So the vertices are the numbers 1 up to n, and the edges are between 1 and 2, 2 and 3, etc. That's the cycle graph. And then we have the complete graph Kn has the vertices 1 up to n, but now we have all edges, all pairs. And there is a notion which we don't really have for tensors. It's called, it's the complement of a graph. So you can take K4, maybe I draw it like this. You take the complement by taking the same vertices, but now you take the complement in the edge set. So you take all the other edges, all the non-edges to be edges. But they're all in K4, everything is an edge. So K4 bar has no edges. Yeah, but if you take, for example, C5, and I take the complement of C5, then if you look at it, you see that it's actually against C5, up to reordering, renaming everything. So that's a very, complement is a very basic operation. Now, as we did for matrices and tensors, I want to define a preorder. So for matrices and tensors, how did we define the preorder? We defined it in such a way that we obtained rank in the end. So here, because we're interested in rank and asymptotic rank, etc., here we're interested in the independence number of a graph. So we want a preorder that gives us the independence number in the end. So that's the intuition, or that's the motivation. So it goes like this. G is smaller than H if there is a map F from the vertex set of G to the vertex set of H, such that for all distinct U and V in the vertex set of G, if U and V are not an edge in G, then they are not an edge after applying F in H. So F maps vertices to vertices, and it maps non-edges to non-edges. But you have to be a little bit careful. So non-edges, it means that U and V are disjoint and not an edge. And then they get mapped to not an edge. Okay. Let me give an example.
Yeah, but you allow F to map U and V to the same place.
Yes.
And then it will, that's why you disallow subspaces.
Yeah, that's right. That's a little bit technical, but this way it works. So you can map. So if you have two disjoint distinct vertices that are not an edge, I can map them to the same vertex in H. Yeah, because H doesn't have self loops, so I can map them to the same vertex, and then it's not in the edge set. It's slightly annoying to do it like this, but this way it's correct. Example. So take this graph. This is K2 bar. Yeah, just two vertices. This is smaller than the 5 cycle, C5. So why is that? Well, I can just map this one to, say, this vertex, and this vertex to, say, this vertex. Yeah, so they're disjoint, so I have to be, they're distinct, they're not connected, sorry. They're not non-adjacent. So I have to be careful. I have to carefully map them somewhere. And these guys are not adjacent, so that's fine. Yeah, so this is my map F, mapping it like this.
But you could have mapped them also to the same point.
No, you can. Yeah, I don't want that actually.
You want to say that really you don't want.
No, the thing is, what I want is that if this is an independence number, which is 2, then I want this independence number to be also at least 2.
Yeah, I understand, but there is nothing in the definition preventing
that.
Does that have to be 1 to 1?
No.
No, it will not be 1.
Right, you want to say if U and V is not an edge, then F of U is not equal to F of V and F of U, F of V is not an edge?
No, no, you don't want to say, because this is a false one-to-one.
Annoying. Let me do, okay, let me do what I...
Things that, I mean, if you have two, if you have two vertices that are adjacent, they can be adjacent, right?
Yeah.
I'll give you the corrective... I'll give you, so I changed this because I thought it was easier, but somehow it's not correct. So let's do the correct definition. So you have graph homomorphism on graphs. So a graph, so there is a graph homomorphism F from G to H. A graph homomorphism F from G to H is a map F from the vertex set of G to the vertex set of H, which maps edges to edges. Somehow in the translation I made it wrong, but it goes from edges to edges, yeah? Which means for all U and V, an edge, yeah, thanks, holds that FU, FV is an edge in H. That's graph homomorphism. Now, I defined complement. So the definition of G smaller than H is that there is a G smaller than H if there exists a graph homomorphism F from G bar to H bar. Graph homomorphism. Now, I didn't like all these bars, so then I thought, let's just integrate these two, and then I think I messed it up. But this is the correct definition.
If you wanted clique instead of independent set, you wouldn't have to complement.
That's right. You can do everything with cliques.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, but then you have to replace. So we're gonna use some product, a strong graph product. So you will have to replace a strong graph product with the OR product, and then, yeah. But people don't like that. People study in graphs, so I decided to do it like this. So, okay, this is the correct definition, but it's a little bit more complicated. But what's the point of it? So you can define, again, so I want to define the subrank of a graph and the rank of a graph. So this is defined as the maximum number n such that, here we go, more bars. So kn bar, which is just n points, is smaller than g. So yeah, for matrices and tensors, we had these unit tensors, now we have these unit graphs.
Well, that just means that g has an independent set of, that is alpha of g.
Yeah. I was going to mention that later, but that's good, yeah. And here we do the minimum. Do you also know this one?
It's the minimum click cover number.
It's the click cover number. Yeah. So let me write it as a lemma. Lemma. The subrank of a graph equals the independence number of the graph. And this is not so hard to prove. So that's why I define it like this. Okay. So let me leave it as an exercise. So we have a product called the strong graph product. And I already mentioned this product when we were talking about channels, and I said, oh, you're going to use the channel twice, then the confusibility graph becomes a power of the original confusibility graph. So the power, the product you're using in the power is called the strong graph product. So it's quite well studied. It's a very standard thing to study. So you have two graphs. The strong graph product, the vertex set is just a Cartesian product, so all pairs. That's easy. And then the edge set, so the way to remember the edge set is to think about these channels. So you have to think about confusibility. And what you end up with is, so edges are pairs of pairs. So these are the edges. I take g comma h, p prime comma h prime, such that g equals g prime or g g prime is an edge in g, and the same for h. So h equals h prime, or h h prime is an edge in h.
So two things can be confused if they are the same or they are correct.
Yeah, exactly. That's how you think. That's how you should remember it. It's about confusing words. These words are confusable if they're confusable in both indices. This is sometimes called the and product, because there's this and over here. You can replace it by or, then it becomes the or product. This is the product, and then there's the sum we're going to use, and it's the disjoint union of graphs. Disjoint union, so that's very simple. You just take the disjoint union of the vertex sets, and you do the same for the edges. So you just put your graphs next to each other. That's how you can describe it. So now, because of this lemma, and because of what I told you earlier about how the strong graph product is exactly what you need to do to study these channels asymptotically, we find that if you now take the asymptotic subrank in this setting, which is by definition now this limit, this is simply the independence number, so this will become the Shannon capacity of the graph G. Yeah, so there we're back at Shannon capacity. So the asymptotic spectrum of graphs, you probably now can guess what it is. So it's the set of maps from all graphs to the reals. Non-negative reals with these four properties. So multiplicativity under strong graph product, additivity under disjoint union, then normalization under this on this kn bar, meaning it has to have value n on kn bar, and monotonicity. So if g is smaller than h, then phi of g is smaller than phi of h. That's just the definition. And then the theorem that comes with this, again, is that if you minimize, you get the Shannon capacity. So Shannon capacity was naturally a maximization problem, constructing independent sets, and now we have a corresponding minimization, and they meet.
So does Strassen's proof give this, or this is
something? Yeah, you apply a general theorem in Strassen's paper. You just need to, well, you need to figure out that you can apply it. He tells you what to check, essentially. I will tell you later what you have to check. I think then you can apply it to other problems if you want. So remark, this Shannon capacity is itself not an X. And how do we know this? The example, it's not so easy to state the actual example, but there are two ways to see this. One is a result by Hamers, a Dutch mathematician, and he proves that there exist graphs G and H for which Shannon capacity is super multiplicative, like strictly super multiplicative. And then there's Alon showing the same thing, but then for addition. So he finds G and H such that the Shannon capacity of the disjoint union is strictly bigger than the sum.
Are these explicit examples?
Yeah.
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 But the second one is sort of contradicting a conjecture of Shannon, and it's extremely surprising. Right? Nogalon's result.
Yeah.
It's a counterexample to Shannon's.
Was it? Oh, was it Shannon? Was it Loewes?
Yeah, Shannon in the original paper predicted that his capacity is additive.
Oh, okay, I didn't know that.
And it's sort of the what you would guess. I mean, it's two separate channels.
I didn't know that. I thought it was so Loewes conjectured that it would be multiplicative, and then Hamers disproved that. And okay.
This is the original.
Okay.
It says that you can send more information in two disjoint channels than you can send in. This is sort of unbelievable.
It's unbelievable, So what we're going to see later, I think, the first time, is that these are not independent, these examples. You can prove one from the other using Strassen's, using this theorem. Yeah, so these were proved independently, but the results are not independent if you have this. Okay, so.
To essentially get the same proof, the same construction?
I don't know actually. I did not. I've looked at Alon's proof once, but I forgot. I forgot the graphs even. Maybe. Yeah. I don't know.
So this theorem that the Shannon capacity is minimum over all Fn(x). If I remove condition two, it still hold true.
Yeah, this you can remove, and this one you can make just sub multiplicative. Yeah.
So Alon's counterexample isn't really.
Oh.
Doesn't really spell.
If you remove this, then Alon, that is somehow not so important for this. And you can, so you can reinterpret this whole situation by saying, oh, because we can put this here, we will see that these are not independent. So that's what I meant earlier by, it's interesting that you can put this. So what are the elements in X? It's not so easy, actually. It's actually, so for tensors, I can give you these three simple examples. Here, I don't think there is any simple example. You should try to come up with a simple one yourself. I think it seems a little bit harder to me. Anyway, so I will do that next week, giving you the examples.
The theta function is there.
Yeah, the Loewes theta function is there. But somehow you wouldn't come up with it.
But
no, I mean not you, but in this talk, I mean you look at this, then you don't think, the Loewes theta number. You wouldn't come up with the idea yourself, just like. So it seems that here,
So that also means that you can't simulate this with tensors. Like give a map between graph and tensor, that takes this.
Why do you say that? Because of.
Because then you would have the flattening.
Say it again. Sorry.
Flattenings for these three.
Oh. Yeah, right. I kind of see what you're saying. Yeah, for tensors, there's this simple construction. Yeah. And here.
Tell us how this comes from some semi-ring, right? So can't you take rank in that semi-ring?
Say it again. Yeah. You want to.
You're going to tell us how this comes from some semi-ring. So can't you do something analogous to rank?
Yeah, you can, but you need to modify. You need to work with it a little bit. So I think what you're saying is for tensors, we get these three trivial points by somehow looking at matrices. And there we have rank, and then we modify, then we somehow modify this to get these flattening ranks for tensors. Can we not do the same thing here? I think the answer is yes, but it needs a little bit more work. It's not so easy. And it will give you, actually, that's the way I think about it, the Hamers bound. But it needs a little bit more work. Yeah.
What if you want to work in the setting of, say,
Yeah, so bipartite, let's see. So what is the...
Because then you have, I guess, maybe a notion of flattenings, which is natural.
You can come up with sub semi-rings of graphs where... Well, for example, if you know that that the independence number is equal to the clickover number.
In general, if you take perfect graphs, you don't need to take powers at all, so it sounds trivialized.
Then you only have a single element in your... So that's another example, Avi, where you have only a single element. But it's very boring. Well, yeah, it's as boring as matrices. So yeah, if you take a family satisfying this...
Yeah, it's not so boring. Perfect graphs are...
Perfect graphs. Yeah, but perfect graphs don't form a semi-ring, but okay.
So what about fractional independence number?
Fractional, that's very good. Fractional is what we're going to use, yeah.
So that's in the...
You say so fractional independence number. So I know fractional clickover number will be in there. I'm not sure if it's equal to the fractional independence number. I forgot the...
Yeah, there is a duality.
Is that the same?
Yeah. Programming duality, yeah. Yes.
So it's a good... we'll see this later.
What?
You think maybe, yeah, okay. I find it a little bit more, slightly more complicated than...
Yeah, but yeah. It's a bad approximation. It's not,
at least it's a simple one.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
In all this, I mean, this, somehow this duality theorem where you allow two operations rather than one seem to give you more. The linear programming duality is what people have normally used.
So let me, yeah, so the I will do it next week. So I want to do the abstract thing now. Let's do that. The fractional numbers.
Tensorized.
Meaning not the being not.
They are multiplicative.
Yeah. Not always, but yeah.
No, no, for the fractional
clicker. Yeah.
And also for.
Okay, so I want to say a little bit about the abstract setting. So, with the risk that it's abstract, so but the benefit of it is that you can then apply it to some other setting if you encounter some other setting, and then you at least know what you should check for. And if you read Strassen's paper, and it's a little bit complicated to figure out what you should do. Okay, so this trying to help you to apply this. Okay. But it's a little bit abstract. So we start with a semi-ring. So you've seen this example, so that should help. We start with a semi-ring, a commutative semi-ring. And I will leave out the word commutative. So what's that? So we have a set, an addition, multiplication, a 0 and a 1. And they have some properties. So the addition is associative and commutative. 0 is an additive unit. The multiplication is associative and commutative. 1 is a multiplicative unit. The product distributes over the sum, meaning a times b plus c equals a times b plus a times c, and 0 cancels multiplicatively. Yeah, that's a commutative semi-ring. So tensors form a commutative semi-ring, and graphs, and matrices, or the natural numbers. And we use this notation. If you take the element 1 in the semi-ring and you add it to itself n times, then I will denote it by n in S. That's just a nice notation. Now we have a pre-order. We've seen this now 3 times. In general, what it means is it's a relation. And it has to be reflexive and transitive. So reflexive means that A is always smaller than itself. Transitive means that if A is smaller than B and B is smaller than C, then A is smaller than C. But that's all very natural. And if you think about the pre-orders that we've seen, so for matrices or tensors, then yeah, they do satisfy this. But this is not enough to apply Strassen's theorem. we need the pre-order to be a Strassen pre-order. That's a name I made up. And what does it mean? Strassen calls it a good pre-order. So I think he invited other people to call it a Strassen pre-order. So it's a pre-order, such that if you take two natural numbers, n and m, then we have that n is smaller than m as natural numbers, if and only if, so let me write like this, if and only if n is smaller than m in the semi-ring. So this means adding a 1 to itself in the semi-ring n times. Yeah. So I want this, I want the natural numbers to behave properly. The second one is that
it's if and only. So it is just
It's if and only. So it means if it's if and only. This should be if and only.
Ah, there are other elements in the semi-ring.
Yeah, there are other elements in the semi-ring.
So the integers are in the semi-ring, but you want
So the for graphs, the integers are k and bar, and then there are all these other graphs. And for all the other graphs, we also have properties. So if you take a, b, and c in the semi-ring, then if a is smaller than b, then we want that a times c is smaller than b times c, and a plus c is smaller than b plus c. So that looks very natural. The third one is it's sometimes complicated to, I've seen many examples where the third one doesn't hold. The third condition is that if you take A and B in S and B is non-zero, then there has to exist a number R such that A is smaller than R times B. R times B, so R times B just means that you take B added to itself R times, right? So every, somehow you can see this, you can view this as every element has an upper bound. You can set B to 1, so every element has a finite rank. But you can also turn it around, you can set, you can say B, elements don't become too small and they don't become too large. That's somehow what it says. And yeah, if you want to check this for tensors, then it follows from the fact that tensor rank is finite. And for graphs, it follows from the fact that key cover number is finite.
Bounded by the number of vertices.
Bounded by the number of vertices, good, so if you have this, you can apply Strassen's theory. Strassen pre-order on the semi-ring. So. So now I'm going to introduce something that we've not seen before, but we can use it in all these examples that we've seen, and it's the asymptotic pre-order. This is somehow, this is an, I think, an invention of Strassen. I think that somehow made the whole thing work. So it's the asymptotic pre-order. So you take your pre-order and then you put the tilde under it. It's the asymptotic pre-order associated to this pre-order. And it's defined as follows. So you
just before you define it, is it natural to just take a definition of rank for this semi-ring to be the smallest n such that your element is less than n?
Yeah. That would be that's what we're going to do. And the same for sub-rank. That's right. I can write it. And the same for sub-rank, or the analogous thing. But so this is somehow a strong, somehow more even more interesting notion than. So here we can define R tilde Q tilde. So I want to move to studying this. Somehow understanding this asymptotic pre-order will make us understand these two. So it's an even more interesting notion, a stronger notion somehow. So A2 is asymptotically smaller than A1 if, okay, so let, yeah, if there exists a family of natural numbers indexed by natural numbers such that two things hold. The infimum over these guys, they're small, so the infimum over these guys, if I take the nth root, should be 1. That's the first. And the second thing is that we want that for all n holds that a2 to the power n is smaller in the normal preorder than xn times a1 to the n. So a2 is maybe not smaller than a1, but when you take a large power and you add a little bit here, small amount, then you have an inequality.
This corresponds to your little n addition.
Yeah.
This
somehow doesn't always work, but for graphs and tensors, what you can do is you can replace this by saying it's a1 to the n plus little o n. I can remove this and view it like this. So a2 is smaller than a2 to the n is smaller than a1 to the n plus a little bit. That's the asymptotic version of the preorder. And this is the object of study now. So examples we've seen, tensors, graphs. So the asymptotic spectrum now, I can simply say, so x of s, comma, so s is a semi-ring, commutative semi-ring. This is a Strassen preorder. Then I define this as, I will now say it more concisely, I will say it's the set of all monotone semi-ring homomorphisms from S to the reals. So yeah, monotone, we understand semi-ring homomorphisms just means that it's multiplicative, additive, sends the units to the units. So that's what we've seen all the time. This is much shorter to write. Now, so this is the asymptotic spectrum in the abstract setting. The spectral theorem of Strassen is that, so now I'm going to relate it to this asymptotic preorder. So the spectral theorem, the abstract version of Strassen is that for any A and B in the semi-ring holds that A is asymptotically smaller than B if and only if for all all elements in the asymptotic spectrum X holds that phi of A is smaller than phi of B. Yeah, so we can characterize this asymptotic preorder using the asymptotic spectrum. So, and one direction is easy to see. If you have this asymptotic inequality, then you can apply phi to the left and to the right, and you do the same thing as I did in this small proof, and you will come up, you get this. It's about the other direction, that if you have this for all phi, then you can actually come up with an asymptotic construction that A is smaller than B. That's somewhat a non-trivial direction. I must say that, so to prove this, you need Zorn's lemma. So it's a non-constructive proof, of course. So to relate it back to rank and subrank, so you can now define rank and subrank like this. You can then define this asymptotic versions in the way we've done it all the time. And it's not so hard to prove from this as a corollary that indeed this is a minimization over the asymptotic spectrum. This is a maximization. Yeah, so it follows from this. That's somehow maybe not immediately clear, but assuming some mild conditions, by the way, but that's not.
So here is where in the reverse direction is where you need the Cadis-Sandoval theory. What does it come?
Yeah. Yeah. That's the non-trivial direction. But it's, yeah. You can make it very explicit somehow. I don't have time to do the proof.
Yeah, that's okay.
So I want to mention a couple of abstract things which you can then apply to graphs and tensors. And yeah. So the first thing I want to mention is this additivity versus multiplicativity business. It follows from the spectral theorem. So let's say Corollary. For any A and B in the semi-ring holds that the asymptotic subrank of A times B equals the asymptotic subrank of A times the asymptotic subrank of B, if and only if the asymptotic subrank of A plus B equals the asymptotic rank of A plus the asymptotic rank, subrank, sorry, of B.
The same is true for rank.
Yeah, asymptotic rank, yeah. This holds for all A and B. It's an if and only if for all A and B. And I erased. So, yeah, that's what I meant by saying that these are not independent.
This is not a constructive
statement. Yeah, it's not a constructive statement, yeah. I think you're right.
So how do you deduce this from the spectral theory?
Yeah, I think I can show you. I think that's maybe the interesting thing to do.
But is it constructive for graphs specifically?
I have to think. I'm not sure. Maybe we'll just do the proof and then... I think no. But... constructive, you say constructive, yeah, I'll think about it.
It's very interesting because the plus and times are not interchangeable in the definition of a ring.
Yeah, so this is what's happening here, we're somehow relating them. That's why, yeah. All right, proof. So, okay. Let's take some element in the semi-ring. Then I want to define for this element element called phi A being the arc min over all phi in X of phi evaluated at A. So it's the minimizer. Phi A is the minimizer of this minimization, then holds that the asymptotic subrank equals phi AA. And also holds that if I take any B, then phi B at A will be at least phi A is A. Okay, good. So now let's do something easy first. Easy. If you take, this is really the easy direction, and maybe I don't think you need the machinery to do this, but okay. I look at Q tilde of A plus B. I know it equals phi A plus B, A plus B. Then I know that this is an additive map. So I get phi A plus B, A plus phi A plus B, B.
You're assuming that it's additive.
Yeah, sorry.
Right-hand side of the corollary.
By definition. That's how I define phi A.
This equality.
Which equality?
Phi is additive, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This lives in X. Yeah. And then, then I know
this is at least
phi AA plus phi BB. Because these are actually minimizers. And well, and this is Q tilde of A plus Q tilde of B. Okay, well, that's easy. And you can do a similar thing for a product. You just replace all the sums by product. Yeah, so then we have this direction. This is something that's just true. And you can prove it in another way, I think. But so let me write the other. Q tilde AB is at least Q tilde A, Q tilde B. So we just start with this. This is what we know. And now we do the interesting direction. Maybe I'll leave this.
For the interesting direction, you know that for one of them you have to play
before. Yeah, I think I agree with you. Interesting. Suppose that Q tilde A plus B is smaller than Q tilde A plus Q tilde B. What does it mean? No. It means that phi A plus B, A plus B is smaller than phi AA plus phi BB. That's just by definition. But this is additive, so I can decompose like this, phi A plus B A plus phi A plus B B. But phi A plus B A is at least phi A plus phi A A, and phi A plus B B is at least phi B B. So these must be equal and these must be equal. All right, and then what do you do now? We take Q tilde A times B. We know it's phi AB AB. And then you upper bound it with phi A plus B AB. This is a minimizer, so this is bigger. Well, this is a multiplicative map. And now we have this statement. So we know that this actually equals phi AA times phi BB. And then you're done.
And the other direction is the same thing.
Yeah. It's the same. You replace. Yeah, or you replace every plus by a times. And yeah. Yeah, I think it's crucial. It seems crucial, yeah. Yeah. So the results of Harmers and Elon are equivalent under this very strong tool. So we see how to apply it to graphs. You can also apply it to tensors, this idea. And that's another example. It's related, let me say it's related to the Schoenhage tau theorem, which is one of these crucial tools used in constructing matrix multiplication algorithms. What it says is that the asymptotic rank of a direct sum of matrix multiplication tensors of different formats, but NI, so cubic format, equals the sum of the asymptotic ranks. And this you can show equals the sum over I of NI to the omega. Yeah. People use this to construct algorithms, but they only use one direction. So the spectral theorem, I think, gives the direction that you don't need to construct algorithms, but it tells you that the tool is somehow an if and only if. Okay, so
this seems somehow with what you just showed us, something is contradictory. We know that asymptotic rank is not in the spectrum.
In general, but then if you restrict to the semi-ring of matrix multiplication tensors. But these are matrix multiplication.
Oh, these are matrix multiplication tensors.
Yeah.
Only for them.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry. Yeah. This is a matrix multiplication tensor.
Yeah.
And the asymptotic rank is multiplicative on matrix multiplication tensors. It follows from this this multiplicativity property of.
Yeah, that's a random self-reduction.
Yeah, it's this self-reducibility.
So you deduce this from the multiplicativity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Strassen does this, huh? This is why Strassen. This is one of the reasons that Strassen writes this paper, to see why is this true, and then he comes up with this whole theory of the spectra, and then he sees why it's true, where it comes from. Because yeah, when people prove this before, so Schoenhager, they did this very constructively, right? They had some constructive proof, and then Strassen comes up with, oh, what's the mathematical reason for this? Well, asymptotic rank is actually the maximum over this set of monotones.
Is there
any other subring of tensors for which this thought that you know?
No, I don't have an example. Identity tensors.
Yeah, exactly.
No, if you take, for example, tensors that are built from groups in a natural way.
Yeah. I don't know, actually. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe I do one more abstract thing, which I like. And it's about sub-semi-rings. It also relates to something we've done earlier, so let's do that. If I have a semi-ring S, and I have a subset of S, which is actually a sub-semi-ring, meaning that it's closed under the multiplication and the addition, and it contains the units of S. Then, how do the asymptotic spectra relate? And it's very nice how they relate. So S is a commutative semi-ring, and I have a Strassen pre-order on S. I can just restrict this pre-order to T, and it will again be a Strassen pre-order. That's easy. Now, what's also easy is that if you take an element in the asymptotic spectrum of S, then if I restrict this element to T, it will be in the asymptotic spectrum of T. That's really easy to prove. Okay. There's nothing happening actually there. The non-trivial part here is that this is all you need to get the asymptotic spectrum of T. So all elements of T can be obtained from this type of restriction. So you could say that we have a surjective map from the asymptotic spectrum of S, the big one, S. There's a surjective map to the asymptotic spectrum of T by restricting. This is surjective. This is not it takes, you need the spectral theorem to prove this. You need,
Where is it useful?
I give you an example. With matrices and tensors. So you have matrices. Not sure how useful this, but it illuminates it a little bit. You can.
Just one dimension is trivial.
Yeah, you just take your matrix and then you can make a tensor of it with one index being one dimensional. Now it's a tensor. So matrices are a subsemi-ring of tensors. In the asymptotic spectrum of matrices, we have matrix rank, but we know that matrix rank has to be a restriction of something here. it's a surjective map on the asymptotic spectra. So this tells you that there is a this gives you the flattening.
Yeah.
It doesn't give it to you because this theorem is not constructive, but it tells you, oh, there exists one, so you should look and start to look for it. So that's how you can use it. So I think that's it. This is the right time, I think.
Thank you.
Yeah.